Now, let us try to understand a little bit more about slip in single crystals. So, all that until now what we have tried to understand is that materials will have line defects called dislocations, and the motion of these dislocations is what we call plastic deformation in crystalline materials. And these dislocations, whenever they move in a lattice, crystalline lattice, they prefer certain planes in which they want to move, and then in those planes in certain directions in which along which they want to move. That means there are some preferred planes and preferred directions. In other words, they are also called slip planes and slip directions, and together they are called slip system, right. So, dislocations move in some preferential slip, along preferential slip systems, and the slip systems are different for different crystal structures. And we have seen that FCC has 12 slip systems, BCC in total has 48, HCP also in total has 12 slip systems. And we have also argued that FCC materials are known to be more ductile compared to BCC and HCP. However, we did not answer the question why BCC, in spite of having larger number of slip systems, is less ductile compared to FCC, right. That we have not answered. That is something for you to think about. All right. Now, we will move forward and try to understand a little bit more about slip in the single crystal materials. As we have discussed, we have three different kinds of dislocations: edge dislocations, screw dislocations, and mixed dislocations. When you subject this crystal lattice to external shear stress, when you apply shear stress on this crystal lattice, then these dislocations tend to move within the crystal lattice. Even if the applied stress is tensile in nature, there are orientations along which you will have some shear, right, because the plastic deformation is nothing but slip. That means shearing of one plate of atoms with respect to other plane of atoms. So, if you are applying load like that, they are not going to slip, right. But these planes may not slip. This load might eventually become effectively a shear stress on some other plane. That is what you have learned through your Mohr circle. Right? If you know your shear stress, the loading applied in a particular direction, and then you can draw your Mohr circle and then identify in other planes how the stress state is. And you can actually identify planes along which it is pure shear. Only shear stresses remain. There are no tensile stresses. Right? That is what you have learned in your strength of materials class. The same applies here too. So, even when the applied stress is tensile, shear components exist at some orientations or alignments to the applied stress direction, and that shear stress is called resolved shear stress, and the slip happens due to that resolved shear stress. Okay? So, the resolved shear stress depends on what? Applied shear stress and the orientation of the slip plane and the slip direction to the applied loading. In a particular orientation, if you want to calculate what is the resolved shear stress, it should depend on the magnitude of the load that you are applying and orientation of this load with respect to the slip plane and the slip direction. So, then slip occurs when the resolved shear stress acting on the slip direction, acting in the slip direction, exceeds a critical value, right. That means it should be able to break the bond, right. So, that means the material will have some resistance, some strength. The resolved shear stress should be able to overcome that strength, only then the slip will occur. Otherwise, the slip will not occur. Otherwise, you will only be causing elastic deformation. If you want to break the bond, you need to apply sufficiently large amount of stress. So, that large amount of stress, that is shear stress, depends on the applied load or applied stress and the orientation of that guy with respect to slip plane and the slip direction. Okay? So, this is, let us say this is a single crystal material, and then you are applying a tensile load F. And let us say that this is the plane on which you want to cause, you want to understand what happens on this plane. with respect to the slip, right? So now let us see that, let us define this angle phi. The angle phi is the angle between the loading direction and the slip plane normal, whichever plane that you are interested in, that normal. And in that plane you have the slip direction. Let us say this is your slip direction. The angle between the applied load and the slip direction is lambda. Okay, so phi is the angle between the normal to the slip plane and the loading axis. Lambda is the angle between the slip direction and the loading axis. Is that clear? Is there any issue there? That's all we have defined. Now, what is the area of the slip plane? If your cross sectional area of the plane along which the load is applied, if this is A, what will be this area? Because this normal angle with the normal is phi, then this area will be A over cos phi. That is pretty straightforward, right? That is the area of your slip plane in which you are expecting the slip to happen. Is that clear? And now, what is the component of force? You are applying a force F in this orientation. What is the component of this force in the direction in which your slip is happening? And that will be the resolved force. The component of that force acting on the slip along the slip direction is F cos lambda. Now, if you have to calculate the shear stress, then resolved force acting on the slip plane divided by the area of the slip plane. That is what is called your resolved shear stress. Is that clear? So now this is your resolved force acting along this direction, that is your F cos lambda, divided by the area. Area is this, and that is A by cos phi. That is your area of the slip plane. Then your resolved shear stress is F by A. F divided by this A. A is your area of the plane normal to which you are applying the load, right? Then F by A I denote with sigma, that I call applied stress. Then sigma cos phi cos lambda. So now we define some law called Smith's law. What it says is that the value of tau r, or critical resolved shear stress, at which slip occurs in a given material with specified dislocation density, some initial dislocation density and purity is there, the value of the shear stress at which slip occurs, and that value is called critical resolved shear stress, and that is the material property, right? For any crystalline material, what is the critical resolved shear stress? That is the shear stress at which your slip in the material occurs or initiates. It is like your yield strength of the material. It's a material property where you have learned in your applied mechanics laboratory. Here we are defining something called critical resolved shear stress, because we are actually talking about shear stress which is causing the slip to the atom planes, right? And we know that metallic single crystals have several slip systems, right? You have several slip systems, and the resolved shear stress may be different for each of these cases. Not all the slip systems will have same resolved shear stress. Each slip system may have different resolved shear stress, because we have seen in BCC there are about 48 slip systems, and each one of them will have different resolved shear stress because the directions are different, right? And in general, what happens is you have several slip systems that are possible. Some of them are favorable, some of them are not so favorable, right? So generally there will be one most favorably oriented slip system amongst all the slip systems that are sitting there. There will be at least one, in general there will be one favorably oriented slip system along which slip takes place. Why? Because when do you call a particular slip system is favorably oriented? When the resolved shear stress on that slip system is maximum compared to all other slip systems. If that is maximum, that means that is close to your critical resolved shear stress. So when your resolved shear stress becomes equal to the critical resolved shear stress of the material, that is when slip occurs, right? So in principle, you can have several slip systems, and all of them may be active, but one of them is more active. So that means if you are calculating the sigma is same on all of them, but this quantity cos phi cos lambda is the one that determines the magnitude of the resolved shear stress on that particular slip system, right? This factor is called Schmidt factor. So you need to, your favorable slip system is the one which maximizes your Schmidt factor, so that your resolved shear stress is maximum, right? So the maximum value of tau r max is equal to sigma cos phi cos lambda max, and we know that slip commences along most favorably oriented slip system when the resolved shear stress reaches a critical value called critical resolved shear stress, and the critical resolved shear stress is the minimum shear stress required to initiate slip, and that is the property of a material. So a single crystal plastically deforms or yields when tau r max in a crystal lattice equal to tau r CRSS. CRSS is critical resolved shear stress. So now you can write your yield strength of the material. So sigma is your normal stress that you are applying. If you are doing this experiment, uniaxial tension experiment on a single crystal material, as opposed to what you have done on a polycrystal material, then the yield strength of the material will be tau CRSS divided by cos phi cos lambda max. Okay, what will be this value? What is the maximum value of cos phi cos lambda? So the when phi equal to lambda equal to 45 degrees, that is when this quantity is going to be maximum. Okay, that means your yield strength of a single crystal material will be 2 times the critical resolved shear stress of this material. You can actually show that the yield strength is a normal stress that you are talking about of a single crystal material is 2 times the critical resolved shear stress. So but one of the, you can use either this as your property or this as your property, both is, there is a correlation between these two things, that's all, because this is what we are applying, this is not what we are applying, this is the resolved component of that. Okay, so and hence if you apply a load in the normal direction along the axis of the cylindrical specimen, then your slip tends to happen at 45 degrees. And if you see a single crystal material, it's a zinc slip in zinc single crystal, you can see the slip bands nicely coming up. So these are all these on the surface you are seeing several steps, right? All these steps are what? We have seen that the dislocation when exits the crystal, you will have a step, right? And you can correlate these steps with the dislocation motion, right? All right. So let me summarize what we have done so far. After discussing that dislocations prefer to move in closed pack directions, in closed pack planes, along closed pack directions, we have also discussed about different existence of different number of slip systems in different crystalline materials. For instance, FCC material has different number of slip systems, BCC has different, and FCP has different number of slip systems. And then if you are taking a single crystal material and if you are applying an uniaxial load on the single crystal material, then you have derived something called critical resolved shear stress. And then we have argued that when this critical resolved shear stress reaches a property of the material called, when the resolved shear stress, is the shear stress resolved onto the plane in the slip direction from the applied load. When this resolved shear stress becomes equal to the property of the material called critical resolved shear stress, that is when slip initiates, and we have actually derived the expression for resolved shear stress. And then you should be, suppose if you know what is the load acting in a particular direction, you should be able to calculate what is the resolved shear stress in this material in that particular slip system. And then if you know the critical resolved shear stress of the material, you will be able to comment whether the material is yielding or not. right? That is where we stand until now. Okay. So it may be a good time for us to solve this problem. You have a single crystal material, which is BCC iron, and on that you are applying a tensile stress along 010 direction. What is 010 direction here? That is your 010 direction. Is that correct? And now, so that is, this is also 01. In that case, this is 010 direction. Agreed? And compute the resolved shear stress along 110 plane. What is 110 plane? That is your 110 plane, right? That yellow one, this is your 110 plane, isn't it? So you need to compute the resolved shear stress in 110 plane in 1/11 direction. Where is 1/11 direction? This is the body diagonal, right? Connecting the body diagonal. Is that correct? And that is your 1/11 direction. So you need to calculate the now the resolved shear stress along that direction in this plane. How do you calculate? First, you need to know, we need to calculate Smith factor when the applied stress is 52 MPa. So we have this formula, resolved shear stress is equal to sigma cos phi cos lambda. Sigma is given as 52 MPa and phi is what? The angle between the force and slip direction, right? And lambda is force and slip plane normal, isn't it? So what is the direction of the force? This is your direction vector. Force is acting in that direction. And what is the normal to the plane? Normal to slip plane is 110. That is what he said, right? Because it's a cubic crystal. If it is 110 plane, the normal direction also will have the same indices. That is what we have discussed. If the plane is 110, in a cubic crystal, then the normal to the plane, the direction vector, will also have exactly the same indices. So this 110 plane will have a normal in 110 direction. Right? Now you need to find the angle between 010 and 110. Will give you what? What will it give? Phi or lambda? Phi or lambda? Louder. Applied force and the normal. Phi or lambda? And this should be phi and that should be lambda, right? So that you will get phi, and then again 010 and 1/11 will give you lambda. You know how to calculate this phi and lambda, right? So that elementary vector algebra, you will do that, and then phi is the angle between, I made a mistake, but doesn't matter. Okay. Lambda is the angle between that, and then the R is equal to sigma cos phi cos lambda, and here phi, the angle between these two guys is 45 degrees and this is 54.7. So the resolved shear stress is 21.3 MPa. You are applying 52 MPa, but the resolved shear stress on that particular plane is 21.3 MPa. And if you change the direction, instead of 1/11 direction, if you choose in another direction, this value will change, right? That is natural. And now the second question is, if slip occurs on the above slip systems, let us say the slip is occurring, calculate the magnitude of the applied tensile stress to initiate the yielding if the resolved shear stress is 30 MPa. Because 23 MPa is the resolved shear stress if you are applying 52 MPa. That means if the critical resolved shear stress is 30 MPa, means it is not actually yielding, because the resolved shear stress is less than the critical resolved shear stress. Now, if you have to import slip, then what should be the stress that you need to apply? It is basically, you know, tau r. All that you need to do is calculation of sigma, right? Pretty straightforward. So you need to apply 73.4 MPa in that direction. And now, if you change your loading direction, you will observe a different behavior. The material will not yield at the same value of the stress, right? Because you are changing the loading direction, and hence the result stress will be less or more, or it may yield earlier or later, and so on. What is the message here? If you are changing your loading direction, if you are going to change your loading direction, you would observe different values of yield strength for your material. That means your yield strength is direction dependent. It is not isotropic anymore. The material property is not isotropic anymore. It is anisotropic. It depends on the direction of the application of your load. And that is very important. That is what we have also discussed, right? If you see FCC material and BCC material, single crystal materials, they have directional dependent properties. And this is one example where we have shown that your yield strength is actually going to change depending on the direction in which you are applying the load. Right? You need to apply more load in one direction, and in another direction you may have to apply much less load, and so on. Okay? So with that, I'll stop, and then we'll continue from here in tomorrow's class.